wonderful band is here, Deja Blue. And we are looking forward to this. They're a fantastic group. We've seen them on the internet. And if the sprinkles will just stop, we'll have a great conversation. Okay. Do you think that this sprinkle is going to let up?
I don't know. I'm thinking about breaking out my Jack Lemmon and singing in the rain song.
Okay.
Singing in the rain. I'm singing in the rain.
What a glory. Oh, I can't sing.
What a glory. But don't. I'm happy again. Well, I'm not that happy, really. I'd be a lot happier if it would quit raining.
Stop.
Yeah.
But I think it will.
Well, we'll have a little faith.
All right. A little prayer here.
Okay. Because a man down in front of me.
Yeah. Of course, with the biggest umbrella in the room.
And he's going to use it.
All right. Introduce yourself to the camera.
Hello, I'm Neville Bitton. I'm the buddy player for Deja Blue. And so we can get out here and make some music. We've got a good little crowd building.
Oh, we have. See, we all have faith that the sprinkles are going to stop. How long have you guys been playing together?
Oh, gosh. I've been in the band around 15 years, and they played a year or two before they allowed me in, before I was old enough.
Yeah, we're going to try to make this happen. I hope the rain is
spared. Yes.
We're just a few minutes out having enough. The minimum to get going here. So bear with us, and it feels pretty good to me if it ain't good on my instrument.
Not raining for just a moment or two, we'll uncover this thing.
I believe the sprinkles are stopping.
I'm not anyway. Well, I just don't want to get shocked.
Do you live locally?
I live in Shelby County in Vincent, so it's about 80, 85 miles for me to come up here, but I do different things and travel different places, and Jasper's been one place I played a good bit lately.
That's wonderful.
And I really like it up this way. It's just awful long ways from my house.
Well, it is, but one of the guys lives in Mississippi. Who's that?
That's our saxophone player, Doug Thomas. He's a band director over at Starkville High over there during his daytime hours. And we're just real fortunate to got hooked up with that fella. He's a fine player, a fine man, too.
Okay, I tell you, we are looking forward to it. There's just a few sprinkles left.
I think it's going to pass. These folks here have got their umbrellas and their seats ready, so they're expecting some music we got to deliver.
We're looking forward to it.
We are, too.
And we're hoping to get a few numbers before it gets too dark.
There you have it. Well, we've got some lights. We'll get them on here and light it up a little bit.
Okay. All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I know it's all part of God's amazing grace, and I believe there's a place called heaven, and I believe in a place called Calvary, and I believe her soul away to be crowned. let us see. And I believe there's a place called heaven. And I believe in a place called Calvary. And I believe in a man.
Oh! one prayer. Y'all give it up.
Mr. Tom Lester, Eb Dawson,
well,
from Green Acres.
Well, wonderful to meet you, Mrs. Lee, and I bring you greetings from Green Acres and Hooterville and all those dear people out there.
Honestly, Tom, you don't look any older. You still look great.
It's see. Any of you folks have what do you call those places that sell glasses?
Gee, really? Yeah. I know, I remember you were the youngest in the class in that whole
yes,
episode.
Ma'am.
But
sure was.
The crew, you were the very youngest actor.
Yes,
but
ma'am.
Now, what about the rest of them? Is everyone gone now except you?
Yes, ma'am. It's real sad, but everybody's
there
passed away.
There might be just a few gray hairs, but you still look the same as
Well, you're very kind.
That television show.
Well, it was a wonderful show, and it was clean. And
oh,
as I traveled around,
thing.
Yes, ma'am. As I traveled around across the country, people tell me that there's nothing they can watch on television anymore.
You can't sit down as a family and watch TV like you could in those days.
I know it's sad. And what's happened is we've gone from a biblically based culture, which this country was founded on, to a postmodern kind of a culture where everybody decides from within themselves what's right and wrong, and that's a fiasco. That's a disaster.
Oh, it is. It is. It was such a wonderful time in the 60s.
Yes, ma'am.
Good, clean fun.
Yes, ma'am. We started in 1965, and we were canceled in 1971. And they canceled us and Beverly Hillbillies and Mayberry RFD, which was a spinoff off the Andy Griffith Show. And they just decided to take all their country shows off the air.
Isn't that a shame?
Yes, ma'am. And we were all in the top 10 and top 20 in the nation, and yet they took us off. Several years later, I heard the same guys that did that, they were on Larry King, and they said it was one of the biggest mistakes that they'd ever made.
Oh, certainly for our culture. I mean, today we have two generations now that are just almost unchurched. Don't you think?
Yes, ma'am, that's true.
And television program, we watch nothing but news because it is not family television anymore.
News and the Weather Channel.
Oh.
That's about it. Yeah, it's really sad. What we're doing, we're throwing God out of everything. And when a country begins to throw God out of everything, then,
oh, you're so right.
Then the wrath of the Lord comes against us.
Oh,
and
well,
you can see what's happening
look what's
in America.
Happening to our country.
Look what's happening because we've thrown we put our fist in God's face. It's really sad.
It is. As a country, we have. Very sad. But those were such happy days.
Yes, ma'am, they were.
And that program ran for, did you say, 6 years?
Yes, ma'am. We started in 1965, and we were canceled in 1971. And it was the first year of color. See, at Beverly Hillbillies was 3 years before us, and they were in black and white. And then Petticoat Junction was a spinoff off of the Beverly Hillbillies. And they ran 2 years in black and white, and then Green Acres came on, and that was the first year of color on television. So it was really neat. We had a great time.
Oh, it was a wonderful program. The elite in Hollywood didn't really appreciate these country programs, but you said you did get some recognition from the Southern California University. Did they not?
USC, they gave an award to our show, and it's the first time a television show had ever gotten that award. It's one of the great television shows of all time. Hollywood never really understood Green Acres. It was a very different kind of a show, and it was surreal is what it was, and we had marvelous writers. And the reason those shows like Green Acres and Beverly Hillbillies, Petticoat, Andy Griffith, Lucy, and all those shows were so good, the writing was so good. And see, most of those writers had come out of radio, and even some of them vaudeville, and they really understood comedy. And then they graduated into television, Green Acres and Petticoat Junction, and all those shows. And that's the reason the shows were so good, because the writers were so fabulous, and they knew what comedy was all about.
Well,
see, like when, like on Green Acres, just to give you an example, Mr. Douglas and I had been working on the tractor, and so we came in for lunch. And Mr. Douglas goes in and sits down. He says, "What are we having for lunch, Lisa?" And she said, "Be having hot water soups, darling." And he said, "We're having what?" She said, "Be having hot water soup." He said, "Lisa." He said, "What's in it?" She says, "Nothing's in it, darling. If anything was in it, it wouldn't be hot water soup." And so about that time, he said, "Look, Lisa." And about that time, I come in. And I said, "What are we having for lunch, Mr. Douglas?" She said, "Be having hot water soup." I said, "Oh, boy." And I sit down and she pours me a bowl of hot water soup. Now the camera comes back on Mr. Douglas and he said, "Lisa, honey," he said, "you gotta understand something." He said, "Nobody in their right mind is gonna eat hot water soup." And man, I'm over there whooping it down going, "Golly, Ms. Douglas makes the best hot water soup in the whole valley." Now the reason that works is because we played that reel. In other words, you folks out there on television and you as an audience, obviously, need to understand and realize that I think hot water soup is really great. I mean, I really loved it. And if you didn't believe that, if I didn't make you believe that I really love hot water soup, then that whole scene goes right down the tubes. Because Mr. Douglas is the audience. He's saying, look, nobody in their right mind's going to eat this stuff. And I'm over there woofing it right down. Golly. And so you've got to make that stuff believable. And you watch television today, a lot of the comedy shows, they don't make their comedy real. They don't make it believable. And it was, but we had a great time. Now, we've got to talk about Mr. Butcherman a little bit here.
Yes. How did you keep a straight face?
Well, you laugh during rehearsal. And you get it over with. You know, if you do it three or four times, then you don't laugh so much. And so, but it's hard. It's really hard, I'm telling you, to keep a straight face.
Oh,
I know. You've got to do that.
Oh, I know it must have been.
They wouldn't let you be on TV now, see. So when you get on someday and you become famous. And you develop an English accent, you don't even know who I am anymore. Just know you got to keep a straight face.
How did your family and friends treat you back in Mississippi after you were on that hit show?
Well, they thought it was really neat, and it's wonderful to be on a running television show.
Well, those that gave you no hope at all of ever achieving anything in Hollywood, wasn't that sweet to come back with something successful going on?
Well, it made believers out of them.
Yes,
see,
it did.
See, they used to tell me when they'd say, Tom, what would you like to do someday? And I said, I'd like to go out to Hollywood, California, become an actor. And they said, you'll never make it because you're too tall, you're too skinny, you're too ugly. You got a southern accent, you don't look like Rock Hudson. And so I tried a lot of things, believing my friends and thinking, well, maybe I can't do this. Yet I knew in my heart, after I came to know Christ, I knew in my heart that this is what God wanted me to do. And my friends would say, well, you'll never be able to do that. And so I listened to them, tried a lot of things that never worked out. Finally, I went out to Hollywood, California, and I went
up
on Green Acres.
You showed them.
Well, you know.
Did they apologize to you later?
No, not really. They were just glad I was on Green Acres. But what's important is that we need to understand that God's got a wonderful plan for all of our lives. And if we'll trust Him, there's always somebody out there that's going to tell you you can't accomplish something in life that you feel like you've been blessed to be able to accomplish. And so you just don't pay any attention to them.
That's right. And all the young people need to hear that and remember that.
That's right. And I can't tell you the number of people that said to me, said, you know, in my heart, I always wanted to do this, but people discouraged me. And then I thought maybe I couldn't do it, yet I really wanted to do it. So I did something else in life, but I look back on it wishing I had at least tried it. And I told Mother and Daddy, I left them crying in the driveway. And I said, I just feel like God wants me to go out to Hollywood, California, become an actor. And I said, at least I'm going to try. And I'd have rather gone out there and tried and failed than never to have gone out there at all. And so if I'd have gone out there and it hadn't worked out and I'd have turned around and come back home, that would have been okay, but at least I tried.
That's good wisdom.
And it's really important to do that.
That's good wisdom for young people to remember that. Oh, Pat Buttram. He was so funny. But you know, the whole family is funny. But their sister Mamie, I tell you, I met them when I was researching my book about Nauvoo. It's a little town over in Walker County.
Yes, ma'am.
And the Buttram family lived in Nauvoo for a couple of years while their father, Mac Buttram, was the pastor out there at the Nauvoo Methodist Church. And so when I found out someone famous had lived there, you know, I couldn't wait to meet the family and get a little bit in my book.
Yes, ma'am.
And so I do have a couple of photos in here. And I want to give you a copy of the book.
Well, you're so kind. Thank you.
Well, and so Mamie, their sister, you know, sisters, they could really cut them down. She said, Pat wasn't the funniest one in the family. She said, our brother Johnny was far funnier. And so she'd cut Pat down to size, you know.
Oh, golly.
So Mamie gave me Pat's home telephone number. And so when I called him to get his, you know, thoughts and see if he could remember anything about Nauvoo, he couldn't because he was too young. But I wanted to talk to him a little bit for my book. And so I called, and of course I yak a lot, so I jumped right in, and he couldn't hang up on me, see, because his sister Mamie gave me his number.
Well, that's right.
So he had to talk to me. And so I jumped in, you know, talking a mile a minute, and I said, oh, Mr. Buttram, I'm so sorry. I didn't think to ask you, you know, if you were busy. And he says, well, I'm watching the World Series, and it was the bottom of the ninth. And I thought at that point, I had already messed up the game. And so I just kept talking. My husband couldn't believe it. believe it, that I did that
funny.
To him.
That's
oh,
funny.
But he was so funny. Even if you remember, even the messages on his recorder were funny. I called once and the recording said something about, he always had a little joke on there. People used to wear tennis sneakers because they couldn't afford shoes. And now they have to wear shoes because they couldn't afford sneakers.
Yeah, that's funny. When I got on Green Acres, of course, it was the first thing I'd ever done. And it's a good thing that God had gifted me in timing and all that sort of thing. And then all I had to do was just learn kind of structure. But when I first got on there and we started some of the scenes that we were doing, sometimes I wouldn't quite understand everything. And if Mr. Buttram was there, I'd go to him. And I'd say, Mr. Buttram, what do they want me to do here? Because our director sometimes had a little trouble telling me. Because he was not an actor's director, really. He was a producer's director, and he was a wonderful, wonderful director. Sometimes he couldn't quite help me understand what he wanted. And it didn't happen a lot of times. I'd go to Mr. Buttram or Mr. Albert, and they would tell me what it was. And I said, oh, yeah, I can do that fine. But they just helped me to understand. And so Mr. Buttram and I became really great, great friends, and I'm really honored to be here today. I think this is terrific, raising money. Let's see, the name of that little club is?
The Civitan.
Civitan Club.
The Addison Civitan Club.
Yeah, and Mr. and Mrs. Suddeth were the ones that invited me here. And they're raising money to help little handicapped children with toys and all kinds of things that they need. And I think that's really great. So when anybody here gets involved and buys some of the little things that are going on that they can buy here or whatever and donate some money, it really goes for a wonderful cause.
Oh, it
But
does.
Mr. Buttram, he was very, very special. And he just had that wonderful voice, as you know.
Oh, he did. And it was a stage voice.
Oh, yeah. He sounded a little bit like that in real life sometimes, though.
Well, maybe revert back to it. He did it so much,
yeah, I think
he'd
revert back without realizing what he was doing. Well, anyway, he was funny, and he always came in with some funny stories, and we just had a great time. The character actors on there were myself and Mr. Buttram and Mr. Kimball, that was Albie Moore,
oh, yes.
And Mr. Drucker, of course, and Alf and Rath the Carpenters, and we'd just kind of all get around and just have a wonderful time just talking about a lot of things. It was just exciting to listen to these people because they'd been in the business for years and years and years. You know, Mr. Buttram was with Gene Autry for all those years.
Oh, that's right.
And that was one of the great westerns of the time.
It was.
That one and Roy Rogers. And what a marvelous heritage that we all have. That's when television and movies were really great.